Good evening, everybody. A very warm welcome to you. My name is Ken Arnold, and I run the programming here at Wellcome Collection. And both warm welcome to you here in the auditorium, and then this is being live streamed, so everyone online who's receiving this, a very warm welcome to you too. Those of you here in the physical venue will see that we're in the midst of a redevelopment project. And in fact, we're sort of in the last throes of the project. So by the end of the year, we will have more gallery spaces. We will have more events like tonight. We will be more curious than we've ever been before. And I guess at the heart of that curiosity, this venue seeks to explore the human condition, always referring back to our core interests in the human condition, but also in medicine and in health. And I think one of the key ideas we have that we try and develop as we take that journey is a sense of how much interest there is in putting different perspectives together. I guess we're hooked on this idea that often it's the cracks between established viewpoints where one can sometimes find the greatest intensity of light. Since 2007, when we've been open, we've put on a number of exhibitions, we've had dozens of live events, and almost invariably, part of that conversation has been the dominant voices of science and art. And indeed, over the last 20 years or so, of the Wellcome Trust's interest in public engagement, bringing the worlds of science and art together has been a dominant theme. And I remember back in the early days of doing that, there was a lot of conversation about the similarities, about the surprising overlaps of how the worlds of science and art work, and I'm sure that's still true today. But I guess gradually for me, over the last years of coming to events like tonight and thinking about these subjects, it's actually the differences that I increasingly think are the points of interest. The sense of the lack of parallel lines sometimes, and even occasionally, the misunderstandings. So a fantastic insight of Isaac Asimov, who said that actually the two words "that's strange" are much more powerful than the one word "eureka." And that idea that finding something odd may be more interesting than finding something settling, something that confirms what you already know, is, I think, maybe a powerful part of what we might discover tonight. So tonight's event has drawn on two luminaries, two stars, one each from the world of science and art. So Martin Rees, who is a cosmologist and an astrophysicist, who was president of the Royal Society, has been a member of the House of Lords since 2005, is in the pink seat. I was going to say, you know, boxing-wise, then in the blue corner. We have Hans Ulrich Obrist, who is an art critic, an art commentator, a curator, currently co-director of the Serpentine Gallery, and I think almost unquestionably is the most articulate voice we have today in making us realize just how significant the idea of curation is for art, but I think for the whole of culture. So in a second, I will hand over to our two fantastic interlocutors. I think I have just four quick things to mention to you before I do so. So the first is to say that tonight's event has been developed in the context of working with fantastic artist Alice Anderson. We are very excited about working with her towards an exhibition that will be hosted in a gallery space just above here in the middle of next year called Memory Movement, Memories Objects. And a big thank you to Alice for helping us pull this evening together. And then I would also like to thank Maud Jacquin, who also has helped co-produce tonight, And from the home team, Natalie Cohen, I don't know whether Natalie is around anyway, running the team here at Wellcome. So a thank you to all of those people for making this evening possible. Second thing is just to remind you that tonight is being recorded and is being live transmitted, and therefore I have to say that if being filmed troubles you, you should probably speak to a member of staff and maybe even leave. I don't hope that any of you think that's too much of an affront. Thirdly, a pure sort of commercial plug. There are books by each of our speakers tonight that are on sale upstairs in the foyer. So do find your wallet and make sure that you buy at least one of each as you leave the auditorium. And then finally, just to say that by after Martin and Hans have had their conversation, at the end of this event, there'll be an opportunity for you to share with us your thoughts and to ask your questions. So do bear that in mind. And when you have those questions, raise your hand and please wait for the microphone to arrive and then speak clearly into it. And I think that's all I have to say, except then to pass on to Hans and Martin. Thank you very much.
Ken, thank you so very, very much, and many, many thanks, of course, to Martin for accepting to do this interview. When the conversation started, actually, with Wellcome and also with Maud and Alice about an event in connection to the exhibition, I mentioned that there was this unrealized project of doing an interview with Martin Rees, and it's wonderful that this can happen tonight. I'd also like to thank John Brockman. It's actually John Brockman, the great impresario, literary agent, and of course, and above all, also publisher of Edge, the amazing website, edge.org, who had introduced us a couple of years ago. And it is actually on Edge that I found a wonderful quote on Martin Rees by David Deutsch, which I thought would be nice as a kind of a preamble to introduce tonight. David Deutsch said, "Cosmology and astrophysics are branches of physics in which one needs an unusual combination of breadth and depth to excel. Martin Rees is arguably the finest all-round theoretical physicist working today." And it's wonderful that we can have this conversation. I thought it would be interesting to talk about the beginnings, to talk about many of Martin's epiphanies, then about the more recent work, and of course also explore the connection to the arts and particularly his interest in science fiction. But before doing so, I thought it would be great to begin with the beginning. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about how it all started. And I know from also Roger Penrose, whom I've talked to about this many years ago, and also from John Brockman, that actually someone called Dennis Sharma played a big role for you at the beginning. And I thought maybe we could start there, asking you a little bit to tell us about these beginnings.
Well, thank you. Let me first say it's great to be here in front of this audience. And I hope there aren't any astronomers here, because what I'm going to say is not meant for them. It's really for a general audience to explain why astronomy and science is part of our culture. Unlike some people, I didn't really have a very firm vector or ambition when I was young. I was interested in the natural world. I remember being puzzled by some natural phenomena. I mentioned two things that puzzled me as a kid. One was a very trivial one indeed. If you have a bowl of water in which you're washing up, and you have tea leaves, you spin the water, and the tea leaves pile up, a little pile in the centre at the bottom. I can never understand why that happened. It wasn't until my third year at university I understood why that happened. But I suppose I was curious from an early age. And the other thing that puzzled me from an early age was going to the seaside and the tides. I knew that the tides were caused by the moon, but then I didn't understand why there were different times at different places. I didn't understand that. Again, I was puzzled, only learned much later. But apart from that, I think I, to be honest, only decided to do maths and science at university because I was bad at languages. And you know, in the sixth form, you've got to specialise, and I was very bad at languages. And so I did science, I did maths, and then when I graduated, I wanted to apply my maths to something that was sort of synthetic rather than too logical. And I thought of doing economics, but I was lucky in that I went into astrophysics, which was a time when the subject was opening up, the first evidence for black holes, first evidence for the Big Bang, etc. And so this was in the mid-1960s. And I was very lucky for two reasons. One was that I had this very good mentor, Dennis Sharma, who was a very inspirational figure, who had several students. Stephen Hawking was 2 years ahead of me, and Roger Penrose was much more senior. He'd been inspired, so it was a very good group of students. And also, it was a very good time, because this was when we had the first evidence that the universe started from a Big Bang, and first evidence of black holes might exist. And it's always very good to start working in a new subject, because if you start working in a well-established stagnant subject, then you can only do something new by doing things that the old guys got stuck on. Whereas if you go to a subject where new things are happening, then the experience of the old guys is at a heavy discount. And so you can really get started and be on an equal level. And so I was very lucky to be in a subject where things were happening. But I've been even luckier, and I'm sure we'll come on to this later, that the subject has remained equally exciting. If you look at what's happened in the last few years, evidence for the very early Big Bang, planets around other stars, is there life out there? All these things are fascinating. So it's been a wonderful subject.
And you told me that it was an incredibly exciting moment also because quasars and pulsars and many different things sort of offer actually a testing ground, a real testing ground for Einstein's kind of relativity theory. And I was wondering, because in the art world, if you look at the artist's work, we can always say, you know, there is student's work, there's the beginning, and at a certain moment, the catalogue raisonné sets in. The artists kind of, you know, often start to number and say, you know, the mature work. And with a scientist, I don't know if there's such a thing as a catalogue raisonné, but I was kind of wondering, in that context of all these exciting things in the 60s, quasars and pulsars, and also the Big Bang, and where would you say is the first paper where you found your language, where you found your discoveries?
Well, I've worked in a rather piecemeal way, so it's hard to answer that question. But since you mentioned Einstein, I would like to say it, because Einstein is unique in 20th century science, because his work had far more individuality than that of most scientists. Of course, the big contrast between science and the arts is that although both are in a sense creative, if you are an artist, even a second-rate artist, your work is individuality. It may not last. On the other hand, if you're a scientist, then your work is durable. You add one brick to the edifice of knowledge, as it were. But in general, it loses identity. And if A didn't discover something, B will 1 or 2 years later. Einstein was one exception to this, in that Einstein's ideas, which developed in 1915, weren't motivated by any real mystery. It could have been 20 years later before anyone came up with those, because it was only in the 1960s that we really observe phenomena where his theory made a difference. Newton's theory was very good for everything up till now. So Newton's theory was fine, but the concepts of Einstein really became seriously necessary from the 60s onwards. And just go back to creativity, I always like to quote talking about the contrast between science and the humanities, a remark by Peter Medawar, a great scientist and also a great writer. And he pointed out that a scientist can't afford to delay because they lose priority. But in contrast, when Wagner took 10 years off in the middle of the Ring cycle to write Meistersingers and Tristan, he wasn't worried that someone would scoop him on Götterdämmerung. That's the difference between the humanities and the creative arts and science.
And where would you locate your first paper, where you felt that?
I think I really worked rather like an engineer in a way, because the initial data was pretty fragmentary. We had rather fragmentary data about these strange objects in the sky, quasars and things behaving rather oddly. And it's rather like being an engineer, where you're trying to make a model of something to meet certain specifications, and you're not even sure you've got the right ingredients to put it together. And so that's really what it's like in a new subject. You're trying to make sense of new data and seeing if you can explain everything in terms of the known laws. And that's what we try and do in science. But of course we have to be mindful that when we consider observe objects which are far beyond everyday experience, tiny things in the micro world or huge things in the cosmos, we may have to jettison our common sense notions. In fact, I think it's rather remarkable that we got as far as we have in understanding the very large and the very small, because after all, our intuitions evolved, I guess, and they haven't changed much since our ancestors roamed the African savannas, and they evolved to cope with the everyday world. That's what common sense is. And it's rather remarkable that we can nonetheless cope with these counterintuitive things in the very large and very small. But that's what we were groping to do from the 1960s onwards, when we had evidence for these very extreme phenomena, which we could study for the first time.
And so that's this incredibly exciting moment in the 60s. And speaking to Gustav Metzger, you know, he once told me the late 50s and early 60s, in so many different fields, so many exciting things happened. But you mentioned that now, 2014, is again a really good time to be a cosmologist, because the last year or decades have kind of become many things become clear, and you mentioned that we basically now can say that the main ingredients of the universe are, you know, 4% atoms, 25% dark matter, 70% mysterious, or 71% mysterious dark energy. You also said it's an exciting moment because we know the universe is flat. Can you tell us a little bit more what is exciting about the current moment?
Yes. What is very exciting is that many things which I thought when I started would never be observed have been observed quite precisely. We can now talk about the time since the Big Bang with 1% precision. We can talk about the density of the universe and the main ingredients of the universe as atoms, but to some kind of other particles called dark matter as well. And we can also trace things back to the early past, because we want to know how things got that way. We look out and we see this panorama of stars and galaxies, and we understand a bit about how they operate, but we want to know how they got that way. How did they form? And we believe it's some sort of emergent process which starts off simple and gets complicated. And we actually have an advantage over, say, geologists, in that we can actually observe the past. We can look a long way away, and because light takes a long time to go a great distance, we look back in time as we look far away. And we therefore can check our theories by not only seeing if they match the present universe, but seeing if they can explain what the universe was like a billion years ago, 2 billion years ago, etc. But what's amazing is this. 50 years ago, we discovered that intergalactic space is full of this radiation, microwaves, and they have properties which can't be explained other than saying they're a relic of the hot, dense beginning of the universe. This is the afterglow of creation, as it were. This was found 50 years ago, and this allowed us to go back and talk with a straight face, even 40 years ago, about what the universe was like when it was a few seconds old. That's quite remarkable. And that's when everything we can now see in the universe would be squeezed down to the size of a solar system. But talk about what's happened recently. What's happened recently is pushing things far back further still, because we understood everything started in this hot, dense state, but we didn't understand why the universe was expanding the way it is, why it had this mixture of ingredients. The answer to those lay far earlier still. And what's really amazing is that we can now talk with a straight face about a much, much earlier stage. Going back from the present time to when the universe was a few seconds old, that's going back 17 powers of 10. But we can now go back 35 powers of 10 more to a time when the entire universe was literally that big. And we have evidence of that. And moreover, just before it got that big, it had expanded by a process called inflation from something a trillion times smaller than a single atom. So we can say that we can trace back everything we see out of the most distant galaxies to something which was smaller than a single atom. And this is not just science fiction. There's actually evidence. The theory worked quite well. And this is one of the exciting developments. But just to say something slightly less flaky seeming, the other big development in astronomy, which we can perhaps talk about more, is that we've learnt in the last few years that most of the stars you see in the sky, which have been wondered at since antiquity by people, we now know are not just twinkling points of light. They're all like our sun, and they are almost all orbited by retinues of planets, just as the sun is orbited by the Earth and the other planets we all know about. We've learned just in the last 10 years that most stars have planets orbiting them, and in fact, that means that in our Milky Way galaxy, there are probably a billion planets, rather like the Earth. So that makes the night sky far more interesting when you think of all the complexity lying just within the limits of a single star. And, of course, raises questions, which again we must come back to, about is there life out there and will we ever go there?
Now, another thing which created a lot of excitement recently is the other gravitational waves. This is kind of news that the Dark Sector Lab, actually near the South Pole, had detected these indirect evidence of gravitational waves. Do you share that?
Well, that was just an extra bit of evidence taking seriously this very, very early stage, because the evidence that we can talk about these very early stages is that the universe contains certain sort of indications that quantum effects were important. And you probably know that quantum effects are normally important in the micro world. So if quantum effects were important on the scale of a galaxy or something like that, it must have been when the galaxy was squeezed to microscopic size. And so all these things that made all the hype are new lines of evidence that we should take seriously in this early stage. I should say that the announcement 2 months ago that an experiment called BICEP 2 had found these fluctuations, I think they made a mistake making such a huge fuss about it, because it was a marginal result, and there'll be about 5 other experiments in the next year getting better data, so we will know exactly what the situation is quite soon. There's always a problem with scientists dealing with journalists. You naturally want to get some attention, but the risk is that the public will get overexcited about things which are still at a tentative stage, and that's perhaps happened now. But nonetheless, if we add together not just that experiment but all the others, then huge progress has been made, and we can really talk seriously, astonishingly, about the universe at that very, very early stage.
Now, another question which has become more urgent recently, and as a kind of a passage on it in your wonderful text on Edge on John Brockman's website, is the question of the environmental side of the subject, sort of trying to understand how, from an initial Big Bang nearly 14 billion years ago, the universe has transformed itself into this immensely complex cosmos which surrounds us and all these environmental discussions that causes. Can you tell us about that?
Right. Well, of course, the aim of cosmology is to understand the very beginning as far as we can, but also to understand how the present universe came about. And the present universe consists of galaxies containing stars with planets around them, and on some planets, on at least one planet, we know, a biosphere evolved, leading to creatures like us able to ponder the wonder and the mystery. And we want to understand as much as we can of this. We're doing this by making much better observations and trying to apply the physics which we understand in the lab to understand stars and galaxies. We've got quite a long way. I mean, for instance, we do understand what makes stars shine. And another thing which I think is a really great discovery was made by my predecessor in Cambridge, Fred Hoyle, about 50 or 60 years ago. And that's the realization that all the atoms in the universe started off as simple ones, basically hydrogen or maybe helium. And the whole periodic table of carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen, the atoms that we're made up of, they were synthesized inside stars. Stars derive their energy by nuclear fusion. They turn hydrogen to helium, then helium into carbon, up the periodic table. And then when they die, they throw out this material into interstellar space, and then new stars form. And so Fred Hoare's wonderful vision was that our solar system formed from gas, which had already been processed through stars. And in that processing, the pristine hydrogen had been turned into a lot of carbon and oxygen, a bit of uranium and gold. And every atom in our bodies can be traced back to before the solar system formed. And we can say that each of us has inside us atoms from hundreds of different stars which lived and died in different parts of the Milky Way galaxy more than 5 billion years ago. And so we are intimately linked to the stars. We are the ashes of long dead stars, or if you're less romantic, we are the nuclear waste from the fuel that made the stars shine. And this is a wonderful way in which we realize the unity of the cosmos, to understand simple things like why is carbon common but why is gold rare. We have to think about stars far away in our galaxy. We're linked to that. Similarly, we would like to understand how planets formed. And the reason it's been so exciting to find these other planets around other stars is that, of course, when you only have one example, you can't deduce very much. And we had our one solar system with our, the planets in it, we don't really know whether it's special, whether it's generic. It's like if you were doing animal experiments and you just had one rat to study, you wouldn't know if that rat had hang-ups of its own that made it unusual, or whether its behavior was the same as all rats. Likewise, when we only had one planetary system, then we didn't know which features of it were special and which weren't. But we now have evidence for hundreds of other planetary systems. And we know something about that question. We find some of them have planets like Jupiter, very close to their star. So lots of planets like the Earth, huge numbers of planets about 10 times bigger than the Earth. And so we now can classify all these planetary systems and really understand how they formed and what, if anything, is special about our solar system. So that's something which has been developed from these new observations. And I think I should put in a bit of preemptive modesty and saying that I'm a theorist myself, but the progress over the last 50 years has been 95% due to better observations, better telescopes, and better computers. And computers are very important because we can't do experiments in space, we can only compute simulations. And so it's all those things which have been so important. Armchair theory wouldn't get you very far. We're no wiser than Aristotle was. So we've made progress because of better experiments. And so it's the engineers and the experimenters who deserve most of the credit, I would say.
Now, one completely different issue, yet it relates to the environmental aspect, is that in the last couple of years there has been an ever-growing interest among many artists in the art world and, of course, in many other worlds, in your books, such as Our Final Century. And it's wonderful because we've got both versions here. It's Our Final Century, and then in America it was translated as Our Final Hour, right?
Yes, well, let me say, I wrote this book that I called Our Final Century with a question mark, and the English publishers cut out the question mark, and the American publishers changed the title to the silly title, Our Final Hour. Americans like instant gratification, and the reverse, I like to say. You know? But what this book was about was the special dangers we confront this century, which perhaps we can talk about, and one of them is, of course, that the world has a growing population, and each person in the world is more demanding of resources and of energy, and impacting more on the biosphere. And so this is the first century in the history of the world, and the world's existed for 45 million centuries, when one species, the human species, can determine the future of the planet. And this is something which is a huge opportunity, but also there's a huge downside if we get things wrong. And that was the theme of that book, which I wrote about 10 years ago. And I think, frankly, what I said now is seeming more urgent in many cases today.
Now, you argue that you're on the cusp of developing an entire arsenal of new technologies that will rival nuclear weapons in terms of their apocalyptic potential, things like molecular nanotechnology and also advanced artificial intelligence. So I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about these advances and the threats they pose, and particularly, I was curious which particular technology you are most concerned about.
Yes. Well, of course, there are the two classes of threats. One is the threats we're imposing collectively by our what we're doing to the climate and the biosphere, causing extinction, etc. But the other thing I'm worried about is that technology is going to empower individuals far more than they were empowered in the past. And it's pretty hard to make a hydrogen bomb, but it may be easier to make biological weapons and things like that. And the kind of thing I worry about is the downside of advances in these technologies, which have huge benefits, of course, because one worries that the misuse by error or terror could be catastrophic, as we have the power to actually modify organisms more. So I do worry about that. And I think we also need to worry about the fact that we are in a far more interconnected world, which makes us more vulnerable. We depend on just-in-time delivery from all over the world, and pandemics can spread at the speed of an aircraft. Panic and rumor can spread at the speed of light around the world via social media. And so it's possible for single events to have a global resonance. Real-world counterparts of the financial crisis of 2008. And so we are vulnerable to these new threats. And this is something which I think we need to worry about and try and minimize the risk of these as possible. And bio is a risk. Some people worry about advanced machine intelligence. I don't worry so much about that, but it's possible. But we do realize that the stakes are getting higher, because as technology gets more powerful, and as more people are accomplished in it, then, of course, even one person can do a lot of damage. I mean, the way I like to put it is that the global village will have its village idiots, and they will have a global range. And I think that's something which is very hard to cope with. I mean, just to take one example, we know there are some extremists, extreme sort of eco-enthusiasts, who think the problem of the Earth is too many human beings. There are certainly people who say this. And it only takes one weirdo with that belief, empowered by the sort of biotech that may exist in 20 years' time, which could be curtains for many of us. And how do we guard against that sort of thing? The lone wolf is very hard to pin down in advance. So I think well, we're straying away from astronomy into sort of issues of politics and governance, but I think it's going to be very hard cope with these growing threats.
Now, the our final century question mark book addresses, of course, this fragility you describe, but it also looks into how terror, error, to quote you, and environmental disaster threaten humankind's future. And you argue that we've grossly underestimated the potential risks posed by modern technology and say that humanity has about a 50% chance of surviving until the next century. So the book was written almost 10 years ago. So I was kind of wondering if you have since then changed the 50-50 odds for humanity's survival.
Well, I think it's most unlikely we wipe ourselves out, but I do still think there's a 50% chance of some setback as bad as a global nuclear war by the end of a century. It may not be a global nuclear war, but it may be the downside of one of these new technologies. So I think we're going to have a bumpy ride through this century, and we've got to be alert to this. And I do feel seriously that we fret too much about minor risks, low radiation doses, carcinogens in food, plane crashes, train crashes, and things like that. We are sort of far too safety conscious in those things. But we're in denial about these other risks, which may be improbable, but whose consequence would be so catastrophic that it's worth efforts to try and minimize them. And I should say that it's one thing that I and some colleagues in Cambridge are trying to generate interest in, to see if we can, as it were, expand the risk register so as to decide which of these risks we should worry about and which can be dismissed as science fiction. Because obviously there are some of these things that you read about which are complete science fiction. Frighteningly, some of these scary prospects may become real in 20 or 30 years.
Now, the other day I spoke to Dimitar Sasselov, who is the professor of astronomy at Harvard University and director of the Harvard Origins of Life Initiative. He brings actually astronomy together with biology.
Yes.
And he said that he would research a lot these extrasolar planets, looking for somehow conditions similar to Earth. And obviously that raises questions of space exploration, and I was kind of wondering how you see this project and this idea also of seeking survival outside Earth.
Yes. It's good. I should say that in Cambridge we've got Professor Didier Kello, who was one of the discoverers of the first planet around other stars, and we have a group doing the same kind of work and origin of life problems as well. I think it's a very exciting prospect, but the fact is, although we understand Darwinian evolution, we don't know how life began on Earth. People are working on this now, some in Cambridge, John Sutherland in Cambridge, Jack Szostak at Harvard, and others are working on this. But we don't know what caused the transition from complex biochemistry to the first metabolizing, reproducing objects. And therefore, we can't tell yet whether this is some very rare fluke that happened only here, or whether it's something that would have happened on any planet like the Earth, or maybe elsewhere. And we also don't know whether the only kind of life is DNA, RNA-based, carbon-based, etc., whether there are other kinds. So we don't know. But it's certainly one of the most fascinating questions, and it's one that one is asked most often by people, is the life out there? And I think there are two stages in that question. We'd want to know, is there any simple life out there? Has this transition happened in many other places? And if it has, how likely is it that simple life on some other planet will evolve into a complex biosphere as it has on Earth, perhaps with intelligent creatures in it? We don't know. People will take their bets, but I think when we're so ignorant, we shouldn't take bets. It could be very unlikely. It could be that the galaxy is teeming with life. But it's so important that I think we should use all the efforts and techniques we can to try and understand it better. But I think Dimitar Sasselov was perhaps sort of thinking about whether we're going to go to these places. Well, I think the one thing we do know is that in our solar system, we know there's no very comfortable place to go. We know a lot about Mars. There are the Curiosity rover crawling around the surface of Mars now. We know what the other planets are like. We know there's nowhere in our solar system as comfortable to live in as the South Pole or the top of Everest. People could live there, and I do suspect that 100 years from now, there will be groups of crazy pioneers living on Mars. I hope there are. We should cheer them on, just as we cheer on Serrano Fiennes, trudging across the South Pole in the polar winter. But they'd be people of his cast of mind rather than normal people. And we can't kid ourselves that we can escape from the Earth's problems by going elsewhere. There's nowhere in our solar system to be comfortable. Now, when we look further afield to the planets orbiting other stars, then, of course, remember they're a million times further away than planets of our solar system, so we can't get to them by any technique we know about. But there may be some planets out there which would be habitable, even if there's no life on them already. But I would say that is going to be a challenge for post-humans, not humans. Now, what do I mean about post-humans? I want to make the important point that astronomers do have a special perspective on the future. Most people, as I said earlier, understand that we're the outcome of 4 billion years of evolution. I mean, if you live in Kansas or Kentucky or parts of the Muslim world, you don't think that. Most people here do think that. But I suspect that most people who are happy with that idea somehow think that we humans are the culmination, we're the end of it all. But no astronomer can believe that, because astronomers know that the sun is less than halfway through its life. The sun's been shining for 4.5 billion years, 45 million centuries, but it's got 5 or 6 billion years ahead of it. So any creatures witnessing the death of the sun won't be human. They'll be as different from us as we are from a bug, because the time for future evolution is just as much as the time that's led from simple protozoa to us. So I think that we should think about the post-human era, and those post-humans will have a technology and a lifespan which will make interstellar travel perhaps realistic. The key question, of course, is whether those post-humans are going to be organic, or whether machines will take over. And of course, some people think that machines of human capabilities will take over in 100 years. There'll certainly, I think, be replicators in the solar system building huge constructions in space in 100 years. But I think if we think in the far future, then entities, I won't say humans, but entities will go to these other planets. Of course, there may be entities there already, but if not, then I think we should not think that life is going to be limited to just this tiny Earth, even if it's only started here, because in the time ahead, life seeded from the Earth could spread all through the galaxy. There's plenty of time for that. So tiny though the Earth is, it could be the most important place in the galaxy. And of course, this gives us an extra motive for ensuring we don't screw it up this century, because if we did, we'd be not only destroying the potential for our immediate descendants, children, grandchildren, etc., but foreclosing this future that could extend for billions of years.
Now, this idea of this urgency of not screwing up this very special planet leads us actually to a conversation I've had over many years with the artist Gustav Metzger, who always says when we talk about ecology, no one really wakes up. When mm-hmm. we talk about climate change, no one really wakes up. But we need to talk about extinction in order for people to wake up. And it's actually the reason we decided now to make it the topic of this year's Serpentine Marathon with Julia Payton-Jones and our teams, and obviously with Gustav Metzger as the inspiration. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that, about extinction.
Yes.
And also there is this book by Elizabeth Kolbot, which just has come out.
The Sixth Extinction. Yes.
And she basically says that over the last 500 million years, there have been 5 mass extinctions on Earth, where the diversity of life suddenly contracted. And she says that what could actually happen now is a 6th extinction, and that could be the most devastating one since the asteroid impact destroyed actually the dinosaurs. Mm. Could you talk about extinction and that 6th extinction?
Yes. Well, I mean, as I said earlier, we humans as one species are dominating the planet and changing the biosphere. I think it's true that 40% of the world's biomass is used directly or indirectly by humans. So we are dominating the Earth biosphere in a way that no single species has before. And of course, this domination is going to be enhanced as the population grows, and even more as we hope the less developed countries catch up. So clearly, the impact of humans on the biosphere could be catastrophic for many other species. And of course, climate change, which is going to be a sudden transition in the habitat and the vegetation, is going to aggravate all these problems. And so indeed, already the extinction rate, I'm told, is much higher than the steady state rate because of changes in habitats, and it could go much faster. So indeed, people call the present era the Anthropocene era, the one where humans are affecting the entire planet and its surface. And if the Anthropocene goes bad, as it were, then of course there will be major extinctions. Of course, there have been extinctions all through. 99% of the species that ever existed have gone extinct. But this will be an unprecedented rate of potential extinctions. And that's what her book is about, isn't it? It's a very compelling book.
There's obviously also a lot of extinction of species happening all the time. And A.S. Byers told me the other day that actually there's a lot of attention paid to, for example, pandas and the danger of pandas disappearing, but we don't really look at smaller beings. For example, she then asked, you know, when have we seen the last time a centipede? When has all of us seen the last time a centipede? And obviously, a species which was extincted are the passenger pigeons, and it's kind of interesting because one can clearly say when that happened. It was actually in the Cincinnati Zoo and happened around 1914. And Stuart Brand, whom we both know well, has actually now started a campaign of de-extinction. Yeah, I was wondering what's your view on this idea of actually bringing these extincted species back to de-extinction?
Well, we all saw Jurassic Park, of course, and maybe that's not crazy, but what they're trying to do, as you imply, is to try and bring back species that became extinct fairly recently, so that the DNA survives in a better state, and the passenger pigeon is one, and the mammoth, of course, is being talked about. More controversially, people talked about Neanderthals, that, of course, is would raise greater ethical problems. And I remember hearing a talk by someone saying, well, if we create a Neanderthal, what do we do with him? Do we put him in a zoo or do we send him to Harvard? They didn't know which. And so that would be an ethical question. I think there are sort of some concerns, aren't there? But I'd like to see a live mammoth. Wouldn't you? So I think we wish these people good luck in doing this and put them in a zoo. I'm not so sure about the Neanderthal.
And before that, you mentioned that sort of, you know, post-human aspect, and that obviously raises issue also in relation to knowledge. And when we met at Hay about 2 weeks ago, you wrote this wonderful sentence for my Instagram, which I'm going to quote here. There are some things we'll never understand. They will have to await post-human intellects. And in a similar way, when you wrote for what scientific idea is ready for retirement, you said there are the same thing. You said that there are certain things, you know, which just we will not understand. Can you talk a little bit about this post-human intellect?
Yes. Well, of course, all scientists know that science is really just beginning. As science advances, we have a growing consensus, but the periphery gets longer and new questions can be posed that couldn't have been posed before. That's certainly been the experience of science up till now, and we are not running out of new problems, and there's a huge amount that we can understand. But I think nonetheless we need to be mindful that there may be some aspects of reality which we may not even be aware of, and which we could never understand. Because, after all, a chimpanzee isn't aware of Newton's laws of motion or Einstein. It's not aware of them and couldn't understand them. And there's no particular reason why our human brains, at this particular stage in evolution, should be matched to understanding all the deepest levels of reality. As I said at the beginning, it's amazing that we have made progress in getting beyond the intuitive everyday world and understanding the subatomic world of the quantum and the cosmos to some extent. But there may be things that we just can never grasp. And I think we need to accept that. Of course, cyborgs, where we're linked to computers, that may help us a bit. But there may be some conceptual limitations for human beings. But we mustn't sort of use this to discourage scientific exploration, because if this became widely believed, it would be engendering defeatism, and that's not what we want. So I think most sciences are just beginning, but at some stage we've got to accept that there may be some areas that we never understand, and there may be some aspects of reality which we're just not aware of. There's no particular reason why we are the culmination and we're matched to understand everything in the natural world.
Now, that brings us, many of these topics, the post-human, the subjects, brings us also to something we discussed earlier about your interest in science fiction and in literature. And I thought that would be interesting here because, you know, the whole conversation started in relation to the question of your link also to art and to literature. Yes. And you often have dialogues and friendships actually within the world of science fiction. Can you tell us a little bit what in science fiction interests you most? What kind of writers?
Well, I should say I'm not an avid reader of science fiction. I've read some of the classics. I knew Arthur C. Clarke a bit, and correspondent with Brian Aldiss, who was instead very excited when astronomers discovered a planet orbiting a double star, because he'd written a story about a planet with two suns in its sky. He was excited they found that. But I certainly hugely admire some of the classics of science fiction. And one person, if you ask me to promote a single science fiction writer, it's someone called Olaf Stapleton. How many people here have heard of Olaf Stapleton? Yes, that's sadly few, but I'd recommend Olaf Stapleton. He was a philosophy lecturer in Liverpool, and he wrote some books in the 1930s, in particular one called Last and First Men, which actually did think about, you know, future, the future stretching billions of years ahead, and also an even more amazing book called Star Maker. Star Maker is a sort of creator of universes, and he had in this book the idea of universe of many dimensions and the idea of a universe exfoliating, as in what we now call the Everett theory of quantum mechanics, when every option is taken and the universe divides. He had all these wonderful ideas. And he was so imaginative, and I think he ought to be well known, and I think these people are very inspiring. Incidentally, Olaf Stapleton inspired Arthur C. Clarke and John Maynard Smith, the great biologist, and they both read the same copy in the same public library in Devon. That's a very nice, the first, same copy of Last and First Men. But Olaf Stapleton, I think, was a real visionary. And I certainly tell my students that they do better to read first-rate science fiction than second-rate science, because it's certainly more entertaining and perhaps no more likely to be wrong. But I say that I'm not a huge reader of science fiction, because it's often not great literature. And I therefore recommend another book, which is a book called Aliens by my friends Ian Stewart and Jack Cohen. And what they did was they, in effect, digested the plots of about 100 science fiction books about aliens. I wish there were more books like that, so that you could actually understand the concepts without ploughing through the whole book. And because it's the ideas which are so original from the I think we can learn a lot from the concepts of science fiction.
And now, besides this dialogue with science fiction and with literature, do you have dialogues with visual artists?
Not so much. I mean, I'm privileged to know quite a few of them. Anthony Gormley and others, and also another sculptor I admire as much as Anthony Gormley, who ought to be better known, Helene Blumenfeld in Cambridge, who I think is a wonderful sculptor. I know some painters. My wife's family knew David Piper very well. We have some Piper originals in our home, so we have some interest in the visual arts. But I've never tried to paint myself. I play the piano very badly, but I've never really tried to paint. But I followed them, and I was a trustee of the British Museum, so I'm interested in that sort of area.
Now, I know we're going to open it soon up to all of your questions. I think I've got time for maybe two or three last questions.
Yes.
I've got about 100 more questions, so I need to edit them now down.
Right.
Actually, one of the things which I thought is very urgent not to forget, and it kind of ties in with science fiction from before, is this idea of the multiverse. It was actually a science fiction writer who years ago, for the first time, explained to me the multiverse, was Bruce Sterling.
Yes.
And the sort of whole idea of these many, 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 many parallel realities.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about the multiverse?
Yes. Well, and basically, it's the idea that there's a lot more to physical reality than what astronomers normally call the universe. As you probably know, if you look through a big telescope, we can see literally billions of galaxies, each like the Milky Way, the distant ones looking like very faint smudges. So we can see out to a huge distance. But there's a sort of horizon to how far we can see, which is set by the maximum distance light can have got to us since the Big Bang. And that's not physically real any more than if you're in the middle of the ocean, the horizon around you isn't physically real. And if you're on the ocean, you don't think the ocean necessarily stops just beyond your horizon. Likewise, the universe may go on far, far further than the most distant galaxies we can see. Indeed, it might go on so far that every combinatorial option is repeated, so that there's another lecture room with another group of people like this doing the same as we're doing. And so it might be some comfort that far beyond our horizon, we all may have an avatar who makes the right decision when we make the wrong decision. But that's not all. Because this is all the aftermath of our Big Bang, as it were. And the most remarkable consequence of some of these theories, and this is one of the issues that comes into the very early universe, is that our Big Bang may not be the only one. There may be other domains of space and time created by other Big Bangs, quite separate from ours, not directly observable at all. And the other question then is, would these other Big Bangs be governed by the same physics as our region of space? We know, incidentally, that all the parts of our universe we can observe are governed by the same laws of physics. The atoms in a distant galaxy, which we can understand spectroscopically, they're just the same as the atoms in the lab. Gravity is the same strength everywhere. But in these other domains that we can't observe, maybe the laws of physics are different. Maybe electrons don't exist, maybe gravity is much stronger or much weaker, and so they'd be completely different. They might not have stars in them, etc. And so one idea is that there are huge numbers of Big Bangs giving rise to huge numbers of cosmoses, but most of those cosmoses are sterile or stillborn, as it were, because the laws of physics in them don't allow complexity to evolve. They don't allow anything like the chain of events that's led from atoms to stars to planets to biospheres here in our universe. And so this is a grand conception, and so in this conception it takes our Copernican demotion one stage further, as it were, and it means that our view of physical reality may be as incomplete as the view of a sort of plankton in a spoonful of water is not aware of the rest of the Earth. Likewise, there may be far more to physical reality. And that's certainly a consequence of some of these theories. And, of course, science fiction has lots of variants on this.
Now, you've written, I think, more than 500 papers, you've told us tonight, so many wonderful things about the books you've written. And I was kind of wondering, are there any unrealized projects of Martin Rees? I mean, Doris Lessing once told me there are the things one didn't dare to do, but then there obviously also the things one so far hasn't had the time to do. There are the things which are utopic, the impossible projects. What are your unrealized projects?
Well, I mean, I would hope my best work is still to come, but realistically I think it's unlikely, given my age. I certainly am continuing to work on trying to understand not only the multiverse, but more mundane, in a sense, questions about how the very first stars formed, how the galaxies formed, etc. Being encouraged by the fact that there are new telescopes being built that are going to give us a far clearer picture of these very early stages when the embryonic structures that our universe consists of are being formed. So I'm very lucky to be in a large institute in Cambridge where we have people making observations by all techniques, space and radio and optical and X-ray and all that, and trying to make sense of it all. And the other thing that's happening is that, as I mentioned briefly, computers are very much more powerful now. We can't, of course, do experiments on galaxies, but we can do experiments in the virtual world of a computer. We can ask what would happen if two stars crash together, what happens if a planet crashes into the Earth, what happens if stars explode, etc. And so we can develop our intuition by doing these experiments in our computer, and that's very valuable. I should say that I myself feel a bit of an academic dinosaur, because I did lots of my own work before computers were good enough to really help very much. I did sort of simple models, etc. But in the last 10 years, the computer models have got so realistic that I tell students they've got to be advised by someone who's more adept than I would ever be at coding computers to make use of the choose computer power, because this is wonderful. And as you know, computers are now used to replace wind tunnels when aerodynamicists want to test wing shapes. And we have no option but to use computers to study things in the cosmos. But it's amazing how much we can do. And so I hope that I can at least work with other people and try to understand these things better.
And one thing in relation to unrealized projects, often when I ask scientists about unrealized projects, they mention actually that they have exhibition projects. And obviously, you know, as this whole conversation started out of a conversation related to an exhibition, as I am in the world of exhibitions, I was very curious about that. When I asked Bruno Latour some years ago, he had all these unrealized exhibition projects as a historian of science, and actually realized that not only it's possible to transmit them as books, but actually as shows. So I was actually very curious if you had any exhibition projects, any curatorial projects you wanted to do.
Well, of course, the one thing about astronomy is it is its objects of study are sort of very photogenic, as you see, everyone's seen pictures of the Hubble telescope and all that. And if you come to our institute, you find the walls are covered with all these wonderful pictures. And so one, and of course, computer graphic movies are now very educational, but also aesthetically attractive. And I think it's wonderful that the new discoveries in astronomy are as aesthetic as the old ones. And of course, everyone's looked up at the stars, and I like to say that astronomy is the one of the oldest sciences, and it's the most universal environmental science, because the starry sky is the one feature of our environment that's been shared by all humans throughout history, and we can now still look up and wonder at the mystery of it, but we can now use modern knowledge to realize it's far more wonderful than the ancients thought it was, and we can understand it and we get close-up pictures of things in it, but it's still got a beauty which can be appreciated by even those who aren't expert in it. And I would certainly myself find my professional work less satisfying if I could only talk to a few fellow specialists. I think it's very gratifying that a wide public is interested in what's up there, is there life out there, etc. And it is part of our culture, and of course it's the most universal culture, because everyone, irrespective of their nation or their faith, looks up at the same sky and wonders about it. And there's far more we can tell them now than ever in the past, and 10 or 20 years from now it'll be more wonderful still.
There could not be a better moment to open it up, Martin. Thank you very, very much.
Right.
So now is your time to ask questions, and actually, so I think the way to do it is that best you raise your hand, and then we can have one of the team members bring the microphone. So please wait for the microphone before asking the question. We also have actually questions, I think, from the live broadcast. So both are parallel realities. Mm-hmm. So what are questions for Martin?
Yes, we're at the back.
There's one here.
Ah.
Thank you very much for an illuminating talk. I have a question about the relationship between science and morality. You gave us a very strong picture of science advancing factually and being the bearer of progress, but clearly by some of the scenarios, the more problematic scenarios you paint in your books, that science has also possibly got some things wrong, or has contributed to the possibility of things going very wrong. And I wondered if I could ask you to reflect a little more on that relationship between science and morality.
Well, most scientific discoveries, of course, can be used to human benefit or the reverse. When a discovery is made, those who make the discovery normally don't know what's going to be used for. I mean, to take an example, those who invented the laser used ideas of Einstein 40 years earlier. They didn't know it would be used for DVDs or for eye surgery, etc. So I think when scientists may do experiments or make discoveries, they are motivated by a search for knowledge, and they can't foresee the implications. But of course, I think scientists do have a special obligation to engage with the public when their work is being applied. And if their work has a dangerous downside, I think they have an obligation to alert the public to that and to engage. But they should do this bearing in mind that they have no special credentials when they get outside their speciality. And I think it's very important, and I feel this is important in the case of, say, nuclear power, climate change, and all these other areas, to keep clear water between the science on the one hand and the policy or applications on the other. Scientists should try and present what is a consensus and what's still uncertain in the science itself. They can present politicians with a set of policy options, but as between those options, they should have no more say than anyone else. They have a special obligation, I think, to engage, but not otherwise. In fact, I had the privilege of knowing, when I was younger, some of the great scientists who worked on the Manhattan Project, Hans Bethe and Joe Rotblat and people like that. And these people returned to civilian life, but they felt an obligation to try and harness and tame the powers they had helped unleash. And they devoted their time to arms control. And I think that's their responsibility, because the other way to put it is that scientists have ideas, and your ideas are like your children. And even though you may not have much control about your teenage kids, you're a poor parent if you don't care what happens to them. Similarly, if you're a scientist, you may not be able to control how your ideas are used, but you ought to care about it. I don't know if that answers your question.
The question, two questions here on the left, one in the middle and one behind.
Could you say anything about how the inventions and advances in photography have contributed to our understanding of the universe?
How
the inventions and advances in photography have contributed to our understanding of the universe?
What inventions have contributed?
In photography?
In
photography.
In photography, yes. I think photography was crucial in the early stages, because if you look through a telescope at, say, the Andromeda Galaxy, you're always very disappointed because it looks a very faint blur. And of course, the images which you see in books are long exposures, and so photography is important. But there was another leap forward in the 1980s, when photographic plates were replaced by solid-state detectors, which are nearly 100 times more sensitive. The quantum efficiency of photographic plates is about 1%, solid-state detectors 80%. So that immediately made telescopes nearly 100 times more sensitive. And that meant, for instance, that an amateur now with a 10-inch diameter mirror, a small telescope, could do the kind of things which could be done with the 100-inch telescope on Mount Wilson, which was the world's biggest telescope in the 1930s. So it's the technology which has advanced, and being able to detect faint objects has been crucially enhanced by replacing photography by more sensitive methods.
It's also interesting that actually many photographers, you know, Wolfgang Tillmans is an example, as teenagers want to become astronomers and then go into photography, and maybe vice versa.
Yes.
Yeah, there's a question here in the middle, and then we have a question in the last row here. Question in the middle here on the left.
Thank you very much. Two questions. Do scientists know what started the Big Bang? Have they any idea what actually started it? And secondly, do you think scientists will ever know what was before? Was there a universe before, or what?
Well, those are really linked questions. I think the answer is we don't yet know. I think the amazing thing is that we can trace the causal chain back to this immensely compact, dense state. But the problem is that the conditions there are so extreme that the physics is very uncertain. The physics is far beyond anything we could ever simulate on Earth in the lab, so it's very uncertain. And that's why all this very early universe, before the first second, is uncertain. But I think we will make progress. But the other point is that one of the things that may happen is that we have to jettison more of our common sense concepts. You're used to the idea that when we divide this table up, eventually we get down to individual atoms, we can't divide it up more. We may find that we can't divide up space and time into infinitely small quantities. We may get down to some bedrock structure where space and time get very complicated. And then the whole idea of three dimensions of space and one of time may break down. And so the idea before and after is not clear cut. But the main answer to your question is we push things back a long way and we've got a lot further to go. But whether our Big Bang will prove to be the only one or not, we don't know. But the whole idea before and after, of course, only makes sense if you have a clock ticking away, and that concept may have to be abandoned. But we can ask the question, how much more is it a physical reality than the part we can observe?
Got a question here in the second row on the left.
Seems an odd question, but we use the word beauty a great deal. You say you look out there and you see the beautiful universe. It reminds me, I saw a dramatization of the discovery of the double helix,
yes.
Crick and so on.
Right.
And during the film, what struck me, it must have been 20 years ago,
yes.
was that Crick, or what's yes. the other one's name?
Watson and Franklin. Yes, it was a wonderful TV documentary,
right.
wasn't it? Yeah, yes, yes.
And he came in and they'd made a model of
yeah.
of the
yes, yes.
structure.
Yes.
And he came in and said, it can't be right, but they said with the technicians mm-hmm. and so on, said it must be right, you mm-hmm. know.
Yeah.
You know, the mathematics is correct.
Yes, yes.
He said, it can't be right, it's ugly.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And when they did make the final model of the double helix, it was beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what strikes me is, what constitutes for you the idea of beauty?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I think, well, obviously, it's two levels. One is that everyone can appreciate the beauty of the sky and nebulae, just as everyone can appreciate the beauty of a rainforest or something. And then you appreciate it at a deeper level if you understand the details. But I think what you're saying really is that concepts have a austere beauty if they are surprisingly simple and unify previously unrelated concepts. So if we think of a double helix as an example, which was a wonderful idea, everyone can understand how it leads to replication. Einstein's theory is a fine example of something which gives a new insight into space, time, and gravity, which is a wonderful idea. The idea of plate tectonics and continental drift, that's another unifying idea which tied together lots of unrelated facts. So I think the great advances in science are the unifying ideas which link together previously unrelated facts, and they have a sort of beauty, and you really see how the jigsaw fits together.
It's fascinating, there's this lovely letter, actually Francis Crick, who co-discovered the double helix, he wrote this letter to his son, and it was before the results were published, and he very excited
yes.
tells his son
right, that's a remarkable
and how beautiful
letter.
It is,
yes,
it's all
yes,
about
yes,
beauty.
Yes.
Now, I've got a question in the last row,
yes.
on the right.
Thank you very much. I'm Dr. Pali De Silva, originally from Ceylon, and it so happens that I was a friend of Sir Arthur C. Clarke,
uh-huh.
about 23 years ago, sir.
Yes, yes.
So I thought you might be curious about that.
Uh-huh, yes.
Of course, I also, as a kid, I set up the first space club in Ceylon about, 50 years ago,
mm-hmm.
right, 60. And of course, the Buddha endorsed that there are billions of galaxies or universes, in Buddha's own words, which is documented, well known, endorsed by Einstein as well. Okay, so this is very interesting, or this whole area. And the question is, do we space travel via our cycle of rebirths? It would be very interesting to explore this. I'd be very happy to be a party to it. Thank you very much.
Well, I think unless we have a sort of time warp, we've got to wait till there's a species that lives much longer before we can actually explore the universe ourselves. But I had lots of emails from Arthur C. Clarke, and I remember he when jets were discovered, looking like a jet coming out of the centre of a galaxy, he wondered, could they be some advanced civilization? We don't think so, but I remember corresponding with him about that.
Ken?
I was very struck by your extraordinary comments of modesty, where you said basically that it was the observational side of astronomy that you thought had propelled our understanding so much. And you know, so you diminished your role as a theorist.
It's a symbiosis, I suppose.
Well, I suppose it's exactly that relationship I'm quite interested in. Crudely, I suppose one could say that, you know, it ties into this question of beauty, doesn't it? But it's your theories that have given the observational astronomers the instructions of what to look for. And I'm sure you might think that's too simplistic, but I'm just interested in how you relate that looking versus thinking aspects of astronomy.
Yes. Well, I think there are some cases when the theory does suggest an experiment. I mean, when Mr. Higgs and his particle was one example, where to complete the jigsaw, that particle had to exist, and it took nearly 50 years before it was detected, because it did that huge experiment. Similarly, some of the ideas about the early universe were developed theoretically before the experiments were able to detect them. But on the other hand, there were lots of surprises. For instance, no one really had any idea what these planetary systems would look like. It was a big surprise to find planets like Jupiter orbiting stars so that their year was only 4 days, very close in, and to find all kinds of things quite different from anything in our solar system. So that's a case when the theorists didn't make any correct predictions. So sometimes the theories can help. Other times they're just sort of wondering at what's out there and trying to make sense of it.
Now we've got a couple of questions actually from our online participants. One question is, have you ever had a moment in your research when you discovered something that truly surprised you?
I think quite often, yes. You find there's some effect which you thought was trivial, but may in fact be quite important. But I've certainly, as have all astronomers, been surprised by many discoveries, many of the kind of objects that I think about, pulsars, gamma ray bursts, and all these extraordinary phenomena. No one predicted them really. And so I think it's the observations which have been more of a surprise than the theories.
Then another online question. In a parallel universe, what career would you have followed?
Okay. Well, I suppose I should say I'd like to be a painter, but I wouldn't be much good at that. I think I've been very lucky with my career, but I think I could have been happy as an engineer. Making things, again, as I said, trying to put things together and synthesize ideas. I did think I'd be an economist, actually, when I was younger, because that's another synthetic approach. So perhaps I'd be an economist or an engineer.
And a third online question, why do you think people are so fascinated by the cosmos?
It is interesting, actually. And I find it very gratifying that there is so much interest. I mean, we're told that the public's not interested in science, etc., but I'm amazed that there's so much interest in scientific issues so far from everyday concerns. Young people are more fascinated by dinosaurs than anything else. Nothing is more irrelevant than dinosaurs. see young people. People are interested in the origin of life. Is there life in space? Is the space infinite, etc.? You know, every taxi driver asks me this question if I say I'm an astronomer. There is a fascination in fundamental questions. And I think that's why, if you look at popular books, they're about the big questions. Origin of life, origin of consciousness, and origin of the universe. And the public, I think, is fascinated. This is something which we share, I think, with our remotest ancestors, wanting to understand what's out there. And of course, as compared to our ancestors, we understand a lot more. We are freer of irrational dread than our predecessors were, because we can understand more. But still, we have the wonder. And I think most people do this. In fact, just going back to education, I think what is really sad is that the enthusiasm which all young people have for dinosaurs and space and tadpoles, etc., is often lost at the secondary school stage. And this is one of the problems, of course, that one wants to instead build on that to get people interested in a wider range of science. But that isn't happening, and this is something which professionally, of course, people like myself are very concerned about. But I think there is a fascination in these fundamental questions.
I think we have time for two more questions. I see a question here in the middle, on the left.
Hello. You said something very interesting and very true, I think, in as much that throughout human civilization, we've always had the stars to look up to. Very recently, we passed the point in human civilization where most people are now living in cities. Over 50% of people are now living in cities. And living here in London, coming from a more rural area, I notice I can't see the stars. And you talk about also like the enthusiasm for tadpoles. I can't find tadpoles here too well. Do you think there's just going to be any change in perspective once you have people who aren't as intimately connected or experienced with nature growing up?
I do. I think it is very sad for both the natural world and the cosmos. And in fact, in my role as Astronomer Royal, I joined forces with the Council for Preservation of Rural England in supporting the Dark Skies campaign. And the point I made there was that clearly astronomers want dark skies. It's not just an astronomer. I'm not an ornithologist, but I'd miss it if there were no songbirds in my garden. And likewise, most people, even if not astronomers, miss not seeing a dark night sky. And so I think it is an important degradation of everyone's environment that many people grow up never seeing a dark sky. You've got to go to a remote part of Scotland to actually see one. And I think that is a problem. And of course, it reduces one of the stimuli for young people to do science. And incidentally, perhaps as a peripheral point, I'd make another thing which has changed. When I was young, kids could take apart motorbike engines, put them together again, simple radio sets, etc. Whereas the technology that young people are involved in now, mobile phones and things like that, are so complicated that they're just magic. And so there's a big gap between the technology that pervades people's everyday lives today and the technology they could understand. And that was not the case 50 years ago or at any earlier time. And I think that is also something which perhaps makes people lose a sort of interest in mechanical things and engineering and the physical world, which they naturally had when they were more in touch, not just with nature, as you said, but also with machines which they could actually understand.
Take the two last questions. There was one question here, in the middle on the left.
Hi. Do you think in recent years sci-fi has kind of begun to guide the direction that technology is taking in terms of, everything, but mainly space travel and things? Like, since sort of you can imagine Star Wars films and sort of books in that area, like loads of money's being thrown at getting technology in that direction, when it could be the answer to traveling the stars could be in a complete opposite direction in forms of travel that we just haven't thought of.
Well, I think in some sense the films are sort of conservative because the aliens always look like humans, don't they? They may not do. But I think, of course, people interested in space travel by humans, they're all disappointed because, I mean, I'm some fraction of this audience is old enough to remember when men walked on the moon. Neil Armstrong's One Small Step. Whereas to the younger people here is ancient history, long before you were born. And that's a big contrast between people of my generation who grew up thinking of it as futuristic and young people for whom it's a past event. So manned space flight is an example of a technology which has sort of stagnated. And so I think most people are disappointed that that hasn't happened. I think that there will be people going into space, but I think they won't be going in the NASA-style way, which is very expensive. They'll be crazy pioneers, as it likes Sir Ronald Fiennes, taking very high risks and great discomfort, and going to some other planet. And I think there will be people who will go to Mars, but the first people to go to Mars will go with one-way tickets, and they just live there. And in fact, Elon Musk, who's the guy behind the Tesla electric car and the most successful private space company called SpaceX, I think he is enthusiastic, and he has said that he himself hopes to die on Mars, but not on impact. I think he's about 40 years old, so he may achieve it.
So it's a question here. We can take two last questions. The question here, yeah. And then the question.
Yeah.
You have so much more knowledge of the universe than the average person in the street. Do you feel your capacity for awe at the universe is overstretched by your knowledge?
Well, I think I'm probably muddled at a higher level than most people because I've thought more about it. But I think the capacity for wonder is not diminished because, in fact, just as if you're a biologist, you can still appreciate the flower in the way the everyday person does, but you have a deeper insight into it. Then similarly, when I look at the sky, I can still appreciate it the way everyone else does and the way our ancestors did. But also, it seems more wonderful the more you know about it. So I think that understanding something, whether it's something in the cosmos or something in the biological world, gives you a sort of extra dimension of wonder, apart from the one we all share.
And there's the question here, at the on the right.
Hello, hi. I really enjoyed your conversation tonight. It was brilliant and entertaining and illuminating. I was going to ask two questions, one to Hans. My question to Hans is, how do you think Martin's interpretation of the cosmos, or just what he said tonight, changes your perspective of curating? And to Martin, my question is to you, you spoke very calmly about a lot of these different things, which to myself, or maybe to other people, would be terrifying, you know, thinking about the sun fading 5 billion years from now, or what we can do between now and then. But how did you come to terms with that? And is there anything that still scares you about this?
You first.
Yeah, to answer your question about curating. I mean, there's so many dimensions. You know, it's almost like in superstring theory. How many dimensions? 11. So there's at least 11, you know, inspirations coming from that. Yeah. But maybe to give you a few examples. One thing, of course, you know, curating this research and you know, this project on extinction, it's incredibly wonderful to learn so much. I would say more in terms of, you know, my question about the exhibition, which I ask you, I do believe that there is an incredible potential, in big part still unrealized, for more collaborations between, you know, astronomy and art. And it came to my mind really when Wolfgang Tillmans actually many years ago told me the story of him having been an astronomer when he was a teenager, and he went to every astronomy conference in the world he could. Parents had to accompany him at the beginning, and he went on his own, you know, start to make this research. And in some kind of way, I do believe that there is a great potential of what actually artists and astronomers, you know, could do together. And, you know, that's maybe something for the future to explore.
Yes. Well, thinking about these, I mean, I don't have agoraphobia, as it were, about the cosmos, but I think scientific understanding does reassure you, because it removes irrational dread, which our ancestors had, to actually understand more. But on the other hand, I think it makes you worry more about different things. I mean, the things I worry about, which I mentioned, are the misuse of powerful technology. But I think my astronomy does make me reassured. But the one thing I should say is that, having lived my life among astronomers, I have to tell you that they're not any more serene or relaxed about everyday affairs than anyone else. They still fret and worry about what's going to happen tomorrow. And I'm the same, I'm afraid. So it doesn't make us any more relaxed about everyday affairs.
Now, I've got a very, very last question, Martin, for you, yes, which is a question recurrent in all my interviews, is that Rainer Maria Rilke wrote this wonderful little book, which is an advice to a young poet. And I wanted to ask you what in 2014 would be your advice to a young scientist.
My advice? I would advise you to be broad in what you learn, learn how to use computers, and pick a subject where new things are happening, because as I said, you then want to be able to do new projects that the previous generation didn't have a chance to work on. So you want to do a subject where new things are happening, or when you have new, much better equipment than the early generation had. And also, another piece of advice I give to my students is don't necessarily work on what you think is the most important problem. There are, in my view, too many people working on string theory, which is perhaps one of the greatest challenges in science at the moment. But what you ought to do is not work on the most important problem necessarily, but multiply the importance of the problem by the probability that you solve it, and maximize the product. And if you do it that way, then you might choose some other problem where you'll be able to make progress and achieve something in your first few years of research, and that'll be a better way of spreading scientific effort around the very long frontier which now exists. But don't feel you've got to solve the most important problem, because you'll just be frustrated. But take a piecemeal problem. It's only geniuses and cranks who can solve the big problems all in one go. The rest of us have to work in a fairly piecemeal way.
I wanted to thank again everybody who made the talk tonight possible. Thank, of course, Alice, who is here, and mention again that this is actually in anticipation of an exhibition that Wellcome is organizing of hers called Memory Movement, Memory Objects. It will happen in 2015. So I hope, of course, many times before, but you all be back here in 2015 for that. I hope you also all be back at the Serpentine in October for the Extinction Marathon. I would like to thank all you who are here present in the room for being with us tonight, for the wonderful questions. I'd like to thank everybody who was online again for being present, the wonderful question. I'd like to thank again and again Martin. Thank you so much.
Yes. Yes. Well,
thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Right. Yes. Right.